as I stood beside my high school desk, I pledged my...
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. This is our 12th annual event that we've held, and it's just, I'm glad to see so many people here today. Each year, we try to bring a different aspect of the Vietnam War to the podium through the speakers who have graciously accepted to share their memories with us. This year, we are honored to have Master Chief Pete Slempa, U.S. Navy SEAL, to share his experience with us.
Thank you. Conspicuously missing this year is the chop-chop blades of the Huey. So in this place, good morning, Vietnam! I'd like to recognize the presence of some of my fellow SEALs who live here in the Northwest. Please stand and be recognized. Thank you. I'm sure if they had the opportunity, their stories would be probably more exciting than mine, because they're younger and can remember everything. With all the advanced publicity surrounding this event and my exploits, I need to dispel and confirm some of the misconceptions. I can walk on water. Only because I'm a master chief and smart enough to wait until it's frozen. And I can fly, but without a parachute, the landings are atrocious. Due to the nature of SEAL missions, we are exposed to hazardous situations. Much of what makes up my resume and my ability to survive is directly attributed to training and teamwork. As verified by the low percentage of graduates from BUDS training, that's basic underwater demolition, which lasts for 6 months and then followed by years of advanced training in the arts of unconventional warfare, it takes a special breed who has the desire, the physical endurance, and the mental attitude to succeed at all cost. However, no matter who we are, where we are, without the support of our spouses and family, we veterans could not function to our full capacity while in a war zone. My wife, Linda, averaged 2 letters a day to me while I was in Vietnam. You cannot believe what type of morale that brought to me. Mail call was, and always will be, the most anticipated event while serving away from home in a war zone. The history of present-day SEALs reverts back to World War II with the advent of the Sea Scouts and Raiders, followed by underwater demolition teams known as Navy Frogmen during the Korean War. The first SEAL teams were commissioned in January of 1962 during the Vietnam War Games. 15 enlisted men and 12 officers were selected and screened from the ranks of underwater demolition teams for each SEAL team. SEAL Team 1 on the West Coast, SEAL Team 2 on the East Coast. These men are known as plank owners. I enlisted in the Navy of August of 1954 and served 2 years aboard the USS Worcester, a light cruiser stationed out of Boston, Massachusetts. I was accepted for BUDS training and graduated in November 1957, Class 19, Coronado, California. In 1993, all underwater demolition teams were redesignated as SEAL teams due to the need for that special type of person to conduct the war that we are now in. After 2 years of extensive training involving diving, parachuting, light and heavy weapons, survival in all of the elements, hand-to-hand combat, insertion and extraction techniques, intelligence gathering, interrogation, language training, and communications, just to name a few. I made my first tour to Vietnam in November of 1964 as a provincial recon unit advisor. My mission was to recruit, screen, train, and operate with indigenous personnel from South and North Vietnam. That had to do with intelligence gathering and the disruption of the enemy infrastructure. The mission for the unit was to, number one, locate and infiltrate enemy forces. Number two, gather and verify intelligence. Number three, identify the leadership of the enemy forces. And number four, covertly apprehend those leaders for interrogation. Our methods and results are still classified. After six tours in Vietnam, I assumed command of the Navy parachute demonstration team known today as the Leapfrogs. I left the teams in 1973 after 16 years due to a severe hearing disability. I served as a zone supervisor and chief recruiter at Naval Recruiting District Portland, Oregon for 8 years, and 3 years as a naval science instructor for the NJROTC program in Brigham City, Utah, for a total of 30 years of service. The military has a multitude of occupations. Each one is as important as the next. The frontline troops could not successfully complete their missions without the teamwork and sacrifice of the support troops, who seldom receive any recognition. When I mention SEAL teams, the emphasis is on teams, for without teamwork, the results will not be satisfactory. If only we can convince our government to accept and practice that concept for the benefit of our country. Most of you have experienced the horrors of war, and the rest of you have probably heard the stories. My personal experiences in the Navy and with the teams are a combination of drama and humor, and with your indulgence, I would like to relate some of both. While assigned to Underwater Demolition Team 11, I was part of a small detachment assigned to Wake Island to blast a channel through the coral for a submarine detection cable. Except for the sharks and snakes, it was outstanding diving with visibility exceeding 100 feet. It was so hot that our working hours were between 4 a.m. and 11 a.m. The rest of the day was in the water, or shade, if you can find it, and holding a cold bottle of beer against your head or forward before you drank it. As you can see, recreation on Wake Island was very limited, if none existed. One Saturday morning, we were not diving due to the excessive number of hammerhead sharks picking up the bits and pieces of marine life after 3 days of underwater blasting. This was going to be our lucky day. We were about to witness history. Maybe not world history, but in the annals of Wake Island. It seems that the Filipinos assigned to Wake Island made a bet with the Navy Seabees on who had the fastest vehicle in a quarter-mile race. The drag strip was to be the little-used runway. The Filipinos had a beautiful coral red dragster with a flathead six and a three-speed transmission. No one knew what the Seabees had until they showed up with a haze gray Navy Jeep obtained from the salvage yard, with a Jadal bottle welded to the back. The engine didn't run, but as you know, didn't make much difference. They had the steering wheel welded to one position, straight forward. The grand prize for the winner would be the loser's pink slip. The Filipinos were on the verge of backing out, only because the Jeep was not much of a prize. However, pride in a large gathering of onlookers, at least large for Wake Island, wanted to see this happen. As both vehicles lined up at the starting line, the dragster revved up the engine and the driver of the Jeep adjusted his harness and helmet, a sign of things to come. When the starting flag dropped, the dragster blasted away with smoking tires, and the Jeep disappeared in a cloud of smoke. Within a matter of 3 to 4 seconds, the smoke from the Jeep engulfed the dragster, and we did not realize what happened to the Jeep until we saw a humongous splash at the end of the runway. The Jeep went airborne off the end of the runway and into the ocean. All ended well, and the CB's can-do attitude won the day and the dragster. I wonder if that Jeep is still there. Back in the early days of SEAL teams, my specialty was high altitude, low opening, called HALO. I was qualified as a parachute rigger and a jump master, and department head in charge of parachute loft and all associated airborne training and operations. The equipment was primitive, with a few Army T-7 35-foot canopies, but mostly T-10s, another 35-foot conical canopy that had some limited maneuvering ability. These chutes were primarily designed for static line jumping from 1,200 feet. When used for halo jumping, the opening shock was enough to make a grown man cry. Fortunately, at that time, there were no grown men in SEALs. Not being able to get anything better off the shelf from various companies making parachutes, we made our own modifications to increase the maneuverability and decrease the opening shock by cutting out some of the panels in the canopy in the form of a double L or a single T. We also tested the same pattern on 27-foot emergency chutes used by flight personnel. These proved acceptable for jumpers under 150 pounds. The T-10s served their purpose until the arrival of the paracommander, a chute designed for pilots having to bail out over the sea to awaiting rescue or to an area away from the crash site. It was also the canopy of choice for civilian skydivers. After a few years, the PC was to be replaced with a radical design called a wing that is still in use today, with some modifications. During the early stages of the development for the wing, the company's representative delivered one of the new wings for test and evaluation to SEAL Team 1. It was already packed by their own riggers. I scheduled a C-130 aircraft for a 12,000-foot clear and pull jump to test the gliding capabilities of the canopy. I exited 3 miles west from the Coronado Beach behind the SEAL Team 1 compound. At 1,200 feet, I pulled the ripcord, and looking up to check the canopy, I found it was configured backwards. So in order to get where I was going, I had to look away from my target and look over my shoulder. At the altitude I was at, the winds were carrying me east by southeast. The ground crew on the beach followed me south all the way to the Mexican border, which is about 9 miles. So that definitely proved the gliding capability of that canopy, even if it was done backwards. As I approached a beach at about 500 feet, I heard a loud crowd of people yelling, "Ole! Ole!" I looked over my shoulder, and there's the Tijuana Bullring. And I said, "Oh, crap." Looking over my shoulder, I saw that if I landed in a parking lot, be a lot better than landing in a pool ring. As I made my landing, the corpsman and the ground crew picked me up. We all ran back to the U.S. side of the border before the Mexican authorities could stop us. Needless to say, from that day on, I packed my own parachute. One month prior to my last tour in Republic of Vietnam, Linda and I were married on March 4, 1971. Linda's father was a career Navy man, and Linda earned a title as a Navy brat. I made some assumptions that Linda was versed in military language when I phoned her from Hawaii on my way back from Vietnam. I asked her to call the team's quarterdeck and relay the following information. ETA for Papa Detachment at NAS North Island 1630 hours, September 22. Request one 1/4 ton 2x2 and one 4x4. Linda was so excited to hear from me that we were on the way home that I repeated that message twice to ensure she had it right. Upon her arrival at NAS North Island, I looked out the window of the plane and saw Linda in front of all the other wives behind the barricades. As we departed the plane, the usual mayhem of loved ones rushing to meet each other. The SEALs were in jungle camouflage uniforms, and from the distance, we all looked pretty much the same. Linda ran right past me in her excitement, and I watched as she looked at the faces of the SEALs behind me. Remember, we only married a month before we left. Giving the group a few minutes to gather and greet the people on their coming home, I gave the order to unload the gear from the plane and load it into the vehicles. As a chief from the teams approached me, he handed me a 2x4 and a 4x4 piece of lumber and said with a smirk on his face, "Master Chief, here's the equipment that you ordered." From then on, my marriage to Linda just got better and more interesting as time went by. She has stood by me through thick and thin and is a key player in our family team. Linda, please stand. Linda, you are the love of my life. Thank you for your support. Will all the spouses of the honored veterans please stand and be recognized? A special thanks to all of you. In the year following the commission of SEAL teams, a long-range training evolution involving two platoons from SEAL Team 1 conducted between the Cuyamaca Mountains and Salton Sea, a distance of 50 miles. The plan involved each platoon to be airdropped by static line about 8 miles apart and to meet at the designated coordinates and proceed as one unit to our destination at Salton Sea. This is desert country, hot and humid. On the third day, we were supposed to receive a supply drop by a parachute from a fixed-wing aircraft. The aircraft never showed, and we did not have any long-range communications to North Island to find out why the plane did not show. We would be hungry for the next 2 days to our destination, but we could refill our canteens at the local farm wells. During the early AM hours of the third day, we were traveling east following State Route 78. I was the point man and walking on the shoulder of the right side of the road. Occasionally, a truck would pass by. The sound of the trucks could be heard from a long way off, and when their headlights were visible from behind you, you knew it was time to get off the road. I was already off the paved surface and walking on the gravel when I heard the screeching of brakes and felt the impact of the truck all at the same time. I felt like I was being run over by the tires of the tractor and the trailer, and then blacked out. During that day, we were all low or out of water. The next farm well was a few miles ahead. In my backpack, I had a can of sea ration peaches that I've been saving for the next rest stop. That may not seem important enough to mention, but when you have been walking in a desert for 3 days with insufficient food and water, a can of peaches was a prized possession. When I regained consciousness, the corpsman was wiping my face with a cold, wet cloth and asking, "Where did it hurt?" I thought to myself, "Are you kidding?" The first words I did utter, "Where are my peaches?" He found the peaches, opened them up, and gave them to me. From then on, everything went good. I didn't care what happened after that. Being in the middle of nowhere Communications was non-existent. The trucker who stopped after hitting me could not bring up anyone on his CB. It was decided he would continue east to Salton Sea to seek assistance. It was close to an hour before an ambulance arrived and took me to the nearest medical facility, which happened to be a veterinarian. The corpsman was a first-class petty officer named Richard Williams. He was 6'4" and weighed in at 230 pounds. When the veterinarian wanted to know who was going to pay the bill before he opened up his office, Rich grabbed him by the neck, put him against the wall with his feet off the ground, and said under no uncertain terms, "You will open this door or I'll use your head to open it." The door was opened. After a cursory examination, I was loaded back into the ambulance and taken to the infirmary at the El Central Navy Base for a further examination and treatment. After a long series of x-rays, it was determined that I had suffered a multitude of bruises, a slight concussion, an injury to my lower back that would presently not interfere with my life, but in some time in the future would cause me problems. I was returned to full duty within 2 weeks. During the early stages of SEAL team training, survival training in the desert, jungle, mountains, and Arctic terrain played a major role in our ability to safely and effectively operate in any area of the world. My platoon attended the U.S. Army Jungle Survival Training School in Panama that consisted of 3 days in the classroom and 4 days in the jungle. The classroom portion consisted of identifying edible plants, catching animals, identifying reptiles and insects that were edible, and methods of finding and building shelters, along with using maps and a compass to navigate through the thick brush of the jungle. We were given the coordinates of our starting point, designated stops, and a pickup point, along with the time frames for each evolution. The Army had a series of dirt roads in the operational area that was restricted to students while in the field. During the second night of travel, we were following our compass heading in pitch black night. If you close your eyes in a dark room, that's what I'm talking about, pitch black. This means you travel not by sight, but by sound and feeling your way through the bush and the trees. Except for the point man, each person has their hand on the shoulder and the person in front of him. This method keeps one from being separated from the group. As we progressed through the night, at one point I stepped into a fire ant hill without realizing it. We were all wearing jungle fatigues but high-top jungle boots and our trouser cuffs closed tight with elastic bands. Without warning, I was being stung on my neck and face by fire ants, and the pain was excruciating. They don't call them fire ants for nothing. Within minutes, I was completely paralyzed. I could hear and see, but I was not able to move a muscle nor talk, because my tongue is a muscle. We turned on the few emergency flashlights we had to survey the situation. I was stripped naked to get the ants off me and off my clothing. The platoon chief attempted to make contact with the base, but the range of the handheld radio in the jungle was very short. It was decided to build a shelter for me and one other SEAL who was going to stay with me, and the remainder of the platoon would attempt to navigate to a pickup point for assistance. We all carried sidearms for protection against the wildlife, and it was decided that a series of 3 shots would be the signal to identify the overnight camp and the rescue team. It was about 0235 when a platoon left to seek assistance. The SEAL who stayed with me and I stayed on a platform of limbs fastened to 2 trees about 10 feet off the ground. I did not feel uncomfortable in that position because except for my face and neck, which were still stinging, the rest of my body was numb and paralyzed. Daylight was a long way in coming to the jungle, and about midday we heard gunfire, which sounded a long way off. It's really difficult to determine the direction of any noise in the jungle because the vegetation seems to absorb it and distort it. At that time, I was beginning to move and talk, and I suggested to my partner that we should attempt to reach a road where we have a better chance of rescue. We heard gunfire throughout the day and responded with our own weapons, but to no avail. Just prior to dusk, we came upon a road, sat down and fired our weapons, and within minutes, a truck came along and took us back to the base. Many lessons were learned that week that served us well in Vietnam. I fully recovered from the effects of the fire ants, and I want to remind you all, fire ants now occupy southern portions of our country. In 1959, while assigned to UDT 11, I was involved in a swimmer delivery vehicle training operations off the coast of Southern California. A total of 6 two-man teams were aboard the mothership, the Bluegill SS-242. The procedure was to lock out of the Bluegill while it's underwater, unshackle the SDV from the deck of the Bluegill, run a triangular compass course of 500 yards for each leg, and return to the submerged deck of the submarine. Reshackle the SDV and lock back in. My teammate and I were number 4 on the list for that day's event. Upon freeing the SDV of its shackles, we engaged the power, left the deck of the SDV, and immediately took a nosedive. The previous team did not recharge the buoyancy tanks as required, and we did not ensure that they did. Two mistakes. Lack of teamwork. Once an SDV starts to sink, it takes a while after recharging the tanks before positive buoyancy takes the desired effect. At about 110 feet, my swim buddy taps me on the shoulder and gives me the signal to go back up to the surface. I shook my head no. The lieutenant in charge of the operations told us during the briefing that anyone who lost in the SDV would end up paying for it. That my pay grade at that time would take over 20 years. I had already set the controls to recharge the tanks and had the stick pulled all the way back as far as it would go. I decided to stay with the SDV. I could see my teammate on his way to the surface. At about 200 feet, the SDV leveled off and began its way back to the surface. With both eardrums ruptured, I had no sense of direction or equilibrium. I only knew that I was heading up because of the light coming from above. After being recovered by the now surface submarine, I spent 3 hours in a decompression chamber and was reminded why UDT personnel receive hazardous duty pay. Shortly after being accepted for NJROTC instructor duty in Brigham City, Utah, during the month of April, I planned a full-day recon of an area of the Wasatch Mountains to identify a survival training site for my students. We lived at the base of the mountain, and all I had to do was cross the road and begin the uphill climb. The weather was clear, the temperature 62 degrees. I had what I needed to spend the night if I had to. As I progressed up the mountains, I had to plow through some remaining snowdrifts. One cannot be sure of the depth of the snowdrift, and it did not take long for me to become exhausted. At about 3 p.m., it started to snow, and within minutes, I was engulfed in a blizzard. Visibility was almost zero. There was no turning back now. I needed to find shelter and fast. I spotted a large tree with many dead branches near the bottom, just what I needed to start and make a lasting fire. Visibility was really getting worse, if that's possible. When I was up to my knees in snow, I took a compass reading of that tree just in case I lost sight of it. I can keep heading in the right direction. As I approached the tree on the uphill side, I could now see that the base of the tree and the surrounding ground was almost bare of snow. Excellent choice, I thought to myself. I took a few more steps and disappeared in a snowdrift. I was in over my head in an unidentifiable snowdrift. I was in so deep that the snow caved in above my head, I could not see anything. Again, I was in a situation where it was pitch black. I had to keep in mind that I was facing my objective when I went into the snowdrift. So if I'm going to escape, I can't go up. I gotta keep pulling snow from in front of me, back towards me, in the direction I was facing. It worked. When I come out of the snowdrift, I was within 5 feet of the tree that I was looking at. My clothes were soaked through to my skin, and as soon as I had a fire going, I stripped down to my underwear and hung my wet clothes on a limb above the fire. I then laid out my survival gear, ate a small box of raisins and one of the two candy bars, and had a drink of water. Gathering up enough firewood to last a night, and setting some pine boughs on the ground to lay on, I put my dry clothes back on and settled in for the night. I knew my wife would alert the county sheriff for a search and rescue team when I did not return home as planned. At first light, I heard the noise of snowmobiles in the valley below me. I put the green boughs I was sitting on the fire to produce a lot of smoke. Within minutes, the most snowmobiles were at my location and were on their way home. Linda and the both kids were at the door waiting for me. Within an hour, I received a call from one of my teammates in Hawaii, wanting to know, how in the hell did you get lost in your backyard? I never found out how he found out about my predicament while he was in Hawaii. Needless to say, I had to make another trip later that month to finish what I started. I wish to express my gratitude to Lee and Barbara Grimes for the sacrifice they have made to our veterans. Both of you will also never be forgotten. Thank you. I also want to give recognition to the museum volunteers who spend time and time again efforts on keeping this museum clean and the doors open. Without their endeavors, you may not have had a museum to visit. Thank you to Volunteer Force. Any of you has the time or the inclination to be a volunteer, you can check in at the front desk at the conclusion of this event. I want to also recognize the members of the committee who made this event possible. Thank you. In conclusion, I leave you with this thought. Our lives begin as a sunrise and end as a sunset. It is what we do in between that establishes our legacy. Thank you all for your service and sacrifice.